bigger points.
Welcome back to welcome back to the Sash and Beard Show. Uh-oh. Got dueling finger points with you can't see with our producer Jody, but
oh my god,
finger guns.
Points. What's up, motherfuckers?
Welcome back to the Sash and Beard Show. I'm Austin Mostolka. This is Alan Pilley. Big things happened this weekend.
A lot of big things.
So along with the Iron Brawl, with which a lot of our lifters, I say our, your lifters.
They're ours.
I mean, they're ours.
They're CTX.
Our lifters competed at. There was a massive meet that happened in Miami, a mere 20-30 minutes away. It was Hybrid Showdown 3.
Yep.
Which, holy shit, stuff went down. A world record bench press, raw bench press happened from Julius Maddox.
Yep.
And Dan Bell, congratulations, Dan. You can come on the show now. So, you know, congrats on getting the 2600 total.
That has to be the snippet that we post.
Absolutely.
For our promo. Yeah, you know, was insane to watch.
Oh my gosh, dude. I watched it from home because we drove back, and every single lift looked so smooth, so easy. Like, it was just incredible to watch.
We were on here. I was telling you, consistency, you know, with his lifting. And then he got out there, and it was just, other than his deadlift, his second deadlift.
You're right.
But the motherfucker pulled it so fast that he bobbled backwards.
Yeah.
It was like, dude, you've got this.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And then he goes and then icing on the cake there, you know, had taken the world record back total.
Yeah.
Total world record with his opener pull. And then went for 903, bobbled it, and goes and gets it again to, like, you know.
Just to go over the top with it.
It was absolutely insane.
Because he said, he didn't say, but like, because he doesn't say a lot, but like, in training, you know, everyone was talking about Dan's gonna pull 900 to seal the deal. You know, that was kind of, you know, that was the talk about it. He's gonna bench 600, he's gonna pull 9, and he didn't need that, but he got it.
Well, even with you, you know, we were talking about how humble he is. You know, he had made the comment. He's like, I don't know about that, and I'm like,
yeah,
okay, you, which I get it.
Yeah,
I get. You know, everybody's like, oh, you know, Austin's gonna do this. You know, and you can be as humble, but that's how he is as well. Mm-hmm. He's like, I don't know about that, and I'm like, I'm sitting here reading that. I'm like, dude, you're gonna do it.
Yeah,
look at your training, man. You know,
I love that about Dan, and you know, I have had limited interactions with him. He once taught me how to better deadlift, which that's a funny story.
Yeah.
So we were in this orange rig. Dan had come down with Seth and Mianna.
Yeah.
That was when he did 1,025.
1,056, 65, whatever it was.
So it was over 1,000 pounds.
Yeah.
You know, nonchalant all about it, and we were deadlifting against reverse bands, and he saw me go, and everyone, like Buddy and, you know, Chad, they were all giving me advice, and then here comes Dan. He walks in, and everyone goes silent. and it was like God was talking to me, because how everyone, like, looked up at him, like, dude. And he said, you gotta throw your head back when you go to pull, not don't have it up when you start, you know, like, you know, really lock it in. And I was like, okay, sure enough. Next time, when got it, because I'm like, well, Dan told me how to do this, so I got to go do it.
Yeah.
Got it the next time, but it was so funny seeing all these guys that I look up to in my own gym, you know, Buddy, Chad, you know, Dylan, all these guys that lift super big weights, do massive things, and they were just silent because Dan Bell was telling me how to deadlift.
Yeah. Well, it's one of those things. I mean, you pay respects to, you know, the greats and things like that, and it's one of those. You don't, when he's giving you free advice, you know, you listen to it, you take it, you know what I'm saying? He don't have to talk, you know what I'm saying? But he does it because he wants to. He wants to see everybody better.
Yeah.
So it's like one of those things when the man starts talking, like, listen to him.
Yeah.
You know? Take heed to the words he's giving you, you know. And that's the thing about him. He knows the sport, he knows enough to look at you and fix things and cue things, and you know, so it's one of those things. Like I said, just said, when he speaks, we listen.
Yeah.
And go and execute. That's execution is one of his words all the time.
Yeah.
When he's standing behind you, especially on the squat, you know, he'll wherever he's at, if he's back spotting you, if you're off to the side, he's like, execution. You know.
Yeah.
So that's one of his words. But he's already told you what to go do. Now execute it.
Yeah. Go do it.
Yeah.
And man, but for him to go and execute his world record total, incredible. And the crowd at Hybrid Showdown was crazy.
It's a totally different type of atmosphere. I'm trying to equate it to some major meets that we've been to.
Yeah.
And I can't.
Yeah. And it goes to talk about kind of the community that Steffi Cohen, who owns mm-hmm. Hybrid Performance, what she has cultivated both online with her YouTube channel and working with, you know, John Call, Juju Movie was down.
Yeah. I got a story about that.
Oh, yeah?
I talked to him. I'll tell you in a minute.
Okay, but, you know, just all of that, all the community, like, from the internet to the old-fashioned powerlifters, Instagram people, like, everyone came together for this Hybrid mm-hmm. Showdown 3, and you know, the results itself show what a great community the powerlifting community is
and can be, you know what I'm saying. Last year, so we were a little different. Last year we went down, CJ competed, and the air, I don't know what it was about it last year, man. Like, you got down there and there's some dudes there who just thought their shit didn't stink.
Yeah.
And I remember, you know, me and Chad and CJ and Sen were down there, and I'm just like, I remember coming back and telling people, I was like, there was just some raw guys there that was just like, why are you like this, you know? Yeah. So to see that last year, not using that one solely, when I come back onto the geared side of things and I see the guys that we lift with and the women that we lift with and the gyms that we go to, mm-hmm. and you see the inclusivity and stuff like that, and I'm just like, this, I love this.
Yeah.
And so that last year was definitely, I don't want to say it left a bad taste in my mouth, but I was like, why are these guys like this? Like, huge egos.
Yeah.
Fast forward this year, to me personally, these guys were better, were stronger, a better group of raw lifters, and no egos, which is so funny, because mm-hmm. it's like, here's this better group. It was like these guys with egos. It's like, who are you? Like, yeah. What numbers? Like, you know, and things like that. Not talking down at them at all, because they're sure. strong as fuck. But sure. it's like the way they acted, and then we fast forward, and these guys that are way stronger than these motherfuckers last year. Mm-hmm. No egos.
Yeah.
It was just crazy to see the shift, you know? So
it's funny you say that. Liz and I talk about this, not all the time, but it's come up a number of times where we talk about guys who are... There's a difference between guys who try to be alpha and guys who are alpha. Mm-hmm. And guys who are alpha guys that are comfortable with who they are, with what they like, what they do. They aren't trying to prove anything, and they aren't trying to tear anyone down.
They don't have to.
Yeah. Everyone knows. You walk in a room, you're the guy.
Yeah.
That's it. Then there are the guys that want to be that, and they see the only way that I can do that is by tearing people down.
Yeah. And that was last year's meet, and you know, which is, you know, I've only ever followed Steffi, mm-hmm. but it doesn't seem like she breeds that, you know.
Yeah.
So it was just weird to see, you know. And then we were there with CJ, and CJ's in his approach to most things very anticlimactic. You're gonna see the numbers. That's the
absolutely
climate. He just sits there. He goes. He walks up. He did not a lot of flair. You know what I'm saying? The weight is
his flair
type of thing.
The only other flair that he has is he flicks the belt when it's done.
Yeah. So like, you know, we're there with CJ, and he's not an ego lifter at all. Mm-hmm. You know. And then to see these other guys, but this year was much different. It was much better to see as far as, like, you know, the community and stuff like that. And then, so dude, the crowd, like, I'm still sitting as I'm talking to you. I can't think of another show where it was just like, holy shit.
Yeah.
The excitement and the electricity, you know, whatever, you know, talk about a show and stuff. So, yeah. And then when the lifts were going down, man, like, we were sitting there talking to Carrie about it. Like, you try to go to leave. You're like, oh, I got to go outside. Let me get some fresh air. And it's like, you hear the crowd. It's like, oh, fuck. Let me run back. Who is this? You know, because it was like all day long.
Yeah.
Flight A to the end of flight D, just lifts all day long. You didn't want to miss a thing, you know, type of thing. So that was pretty neat to see.
Yeah.
But
what's your Juju story?
So Juju is sitting in the back, and he changed singlets every single lift. He brought 9 singlets. And I think on his second deadlift, I want to say it was his second deadlift, he comes out in an all pink singlet.
Mm. Yeah.
And
yeah,
I look up and I'm like, oh, fuck yeah. So I tap him and I said, hey, dude, where'd you get this singlet? And he's like, oh, some lady in Canada, she made it for me. And I was like, oh, you know, I was like, I'm going to have to find you. I was like, obviously, I'll find you on YouTube because of who you are.
Yeah.
I was like, but I'll reach out to you if you can remember. I want to find out. I got to get that. I told him, I was like, I rock pink everything.
Yeah.
And I only wear a singlet for my bench because mm-hmm. of the suits and stuff for deadlift and squat. So I'm sitting there thinking, I was like, oh, you know, let me get this pink. But I'm talking to this man and he's talking back, you know, so that yet again, you know, who he is, you know, and he's just, who am I? You know, he's talking to me.
Right.
You know,
he's just like, yeah, of course, yeah, like he's such a cool dude.
He is, you know, and so just the banter, but I actually got to talk to him,
yeah,
and he talked back, and I was like, yeah, man,
so that's pretty sweet.
Yeah, that was my story. So
definitely,
but back there, literally from start to finish with Dan, like, all his warm ups. We were out there. We were on the platform for it was 11:02. So that was pretty neat to see. We're right off the side of the stage for I believe it's going to be a 601. His 600 bench.
It was 600 point like
something. Yeah, yeah.
It was something like that.
And then the deadlift. You know, you got up there, and so the lead up to that, from what I had heard from I think Seth and Danny, was he was going to open, and then on his second attempt he was going to lock in the total.
Okay.
And then after that, go for broke.
Mm-hmm.
So he opens up 860. 860 put him 2.5 kilos over to take the record back. And then he went 903 and bobbled at the top and then put an extra 43 pounds to cushion that to go 2606 on his third pull.
Yeah.
Just back to electrifying, man. Like, insane.
Yeah.
His reaction, the crowd's reaction, it was absolutely amazing to see. To be a part of that, you know, the live.
Yeah.
That was something else. So
super awesome.
Yeah.
And then the bench press world record.
Yep.
Julius Maddox. Which, okay, I understand that he is a bench press specialist.
Mm-hmm.
But it was still weird to me seeing his name at the bottom of every flight, but him not doing squat or deadlift. Is that normal? Is someone newer to
normal.
This?
So it's all about a total. So you'll see all the lifters. You may have seen him in the squat, but he'll be at the bottom. He's not going to take squat attempts.
Yeah.
And then obviously you see him when he gets to the bench. And where you saw Dan Bell's numbers going across, best squat, best bench, best deadlift, you see all that. We'll come back to the bench because then it's Julius. And so then he starts to do his bench and stuff like that. So then he's added in. But yeah, they'll put him in towards the bottom of that flight just for record keeping and namesake and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But
he hit 783.
So yeah.
So he had 783, which is beating his own world record by 13 pounds because it was 770. Chad and Joe were the spotters for it.
They got up there on that one.
And yeah.
Blown up all over different pages, seeing the two of them on there.
that's so much fun to see. But he hit it on his second attempt.
Yeah.
And a lot of chatter around social media was that, oh, he's going to go for 800, but he didn't take a third attempt. And it's because, according to internet, I would say pretty confirmed rumors.
Yeah.
He's contracted to go for an 800-pound bench press, similar how he tried last time. He was contracted through the same people that did Half Thor's 501 deadlift, all that sort of stuff. But he's contracted to go for an 800-pound bench press later in the year, and so he is not physically allowed to put 800 pounds on a bar per his contract.
Mm-hmm.
That's crazy to me. I mean, immediately some of my questions are, well, there's a lot of risk involved with that because what if your training goes sideways? What if you get an injury? You know,
those are all things that you, as a power lifter, you know, you. We don't. I don't. So this is weird to say. I don't want to say we plan for it.
Mm-hmm.
Shit could happen.
Yeah.
And when it happens, we know where to go pretty quickly.
Uh-huh.
It's not like we get hurt. What do we do? When and if we get hurt, boom, we know what to go do. But I'm not planning for an injury.
Yeah.
I don't train you guys that way either. You know what I'm saying? So you know, and Julius is training. He's he does his stuff. He does his reps. He does his sets. He does his stuff. And if game time, it's there. Great. If it's not, you know, type of thing. If he gets injured, you know, there's things put in, you know, sports.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, when these guys sign these multi-million dollar contracts, they get bonuses.
Yeah.
You know, if I rush for 2,000 yards, if I rush for 1,000, I get 16 sacks in a season, things like that. And if I don't, well, then here's what happens. Also, in my contract, if I get injured, what's my pay? Do I still get my game check? What's the percentage? So, you know, all that stuff is duked out between him and his sponsors.
Right.
So, you know, back to consistency. I mean, he's, other than the one that was the misload. Yeah.
Yeah.
Other than that, I mean, he's walked out, set a record. You know, so he's doing the same thing kind of like Dan. I mean, he's being consistent, and it's showing in his training and going out on the platform.
Yeah.
And he put up 782.
Yeah.
Point whatever.
Yeah.
783.
Yeah. We'll call it 783.
But yeah. So
I guess my one other question about the, you know, the contracted lifts, and does that take away from some of, like, Hybrid Showdown 3, massive meet, you know, big lifters, we're seeing world record attempts, we're seeing all this, but we didn't see his best. Does that take away from, like, it's his best so far that we've seen, but we didn't see his full effort because we know that he's got more in the tank. Does that take anything away, or from, what do you think?
From a spectator standpoint, maybe, you know, it's like, oh man, we came down here to see Julius hit eight and we didn't know, you know, and I'm not saying like us going to the meet, I'm talking about spectators.
Sure.
Spectators didn't know this.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? They didn't know like, oh, you know, why didn't Julius go for eight? We didn't know he's under contract.
Right.
But when Hybrid gets Julius to come there, they're going to know. You know what I'm saying? So as far as, like, you know, legitimacy to the meets, like, whoever, you know, well, let's just keep assuming Steffi. When Steffi asked Julius to be there, like, hey, look, like, I want you to come. And then at that point, Julius would be like, well, I can't hit eight. Mm-hmm. And at that point, if Steffi still wants Julius to come, then Julius comes. If not, then don't show up.
Yeah.
You know, that type of thing. But so as far as, like, to add legitimacy to the meet, he still came down there because people still want to see him.
Absolutely.
Regardless of lifting, they want to come down, they want to meet him, they want to see him, shake hands, get autographs, things like take photos. But then, okay, I can come break a record. I just can't hit eight.
Right.
Okay, done. So contract talks, you know what I'm saying?
Like, yeah, yeah.
And if that's the make or break is the 800, well then Julius doesn't show up.
Right.
But, you know, from a business standpoint and his name and who he is, just like Dan, you know you're going to sell tickets.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And just saying, it didn't happen obviously, but saying Dan didn't hit 2,600. You're still coming to see Dan try.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah,
because people know shit happens.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? So you're still coming down to see Dan. People are traveling all over to come down here to see him attempt this.
Right.
And at least give it a go.
Yeah.
And you stick around from squat to bench to deadlift. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, I still have you in my gym. I'm still making money off you buying shirts and food and things like that. So from a business standpoint,
it still makes sense.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
You know, as far as the contracts, like I said, is, you know, if I want you to bench 800 at my meet, I lock that contract up.
Right.
And whoever got the first dibs on him for Julius to go do that.
Yeah.
You know, so
that's kind of crazy.
I don't think that it's an illegitimate meet in my opinion.
Sure.
Because once again, coming back to it, wherever he's contractually obligated to go hit eight, I hope it happens, but it could not happen. So it's like, okay, well, at that point, what happens now?
Yeah.
Is that an illegitimate meet because he didn't do it at the meet? No.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Contract talks. I had to save myself. I had to be prepared. And as an athlete, you know, coming back to sports, you know, there's certain contractual terms and talks where maybe I can't ride motorcycles or I can't engage in MMA or I can't go do rock climbing. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like,
there's
I'm owned by the NFL type of thing.
There's a guy who played for, I think, the Bucks. He's contractually not allowed to go surfing because when he was younger he was a surf pro.
Yeah.
And so now that he is a professional in another sport, he's not allowed to go surfing.
Jameis was a dual sport. He was contractually obligated to not play baseball.
Yeah.
Kellen Winslow, you know, in the news now for other reasons, but dirt bikes or motorcycles, you know, Big Ben. You know, he got in his accident.
Motorcycles.
You know?
Yeah.
So these are things. So, you know, I'm sure, you know, as big of a name as Julius is in his contract, there might be things that he can't go do.
Mm-hmm.
Hey, I got to keep you safe to get to this meet to come bench eight. So, you know,
pretty
I don't know.
Crazy.
Like I said, in my opinion, not illegitimate at all. Awesome meet. He came down. He broke his own world record. People saw a world record broke.
Yeah.
And now the build up, you know, to this other meet to go see eight. So.
And it did big things on social media.
Humongous.
I mean, I posted about it on my radio station's.
And that's what I'm
website.
Saying. So it was only 783.
Yeah.
Everybody wants to see the eight fall, but look at how many people
got hyped
posted, tweeted, came down, saw to come see him anyway to bench 783.
Yeah.
And they were just as fucking excited.
Absolutely.
You know, that he was there.
Yeah.
You know, in the warm up. Oh man, in the warm up room. What did he have? He had six blues, his 585 through 70 on it, 655.
Jeez.
655 in the warm up.
Jeez.
Just moving like butter. It's like just, you know what I mean?
That's insane.
So and this is the you know, they and I get it, you know, they're trying to run it. You're back here in the warm up room, they're like, oh, if you were not a coach and you were not a lifter, get the fuck out.
Yeah.
But
But you want to watch that.
You want to watch that. You know what I'm saying? Like, you know, so I get it from the business standpoint and the safety standpoint and from the athlete. But, like, you know.
Yeah.
Like, bullpen. You know, we're over here trying to watch some motherfucker warm up and shit. We're all around just, you know.
Yeah.
You know, I'm trying to equate it to other sports for people, you know. But, like, you want to see this motherfucker warm up, you know.
Yeah.
He's just, he's moving weights. That are, you know,
it's like a pitcher throwing 100 miles an hour.
Yeah,
perhaps, you know?
Yeah, you want to see
you
that.
You see him build up, and you see the lightning quickness.
Yeah,
of it. Yeah.
You know, you want to be right there to hear that thwack as the ball absolutely. Hits the catcher's mitt. You know, I don't know.
You want to see the gun go with the. Yeah, you know, yeah, absolutely. Yeah,
so being back there, you know, in the warm up area, and being able to see that, like, it was just, dude, it was an amazing day.
Awesome.
Yeah,
that's super cool.
But yeah,
well,
congrats, Dan.
Well done, Dan.
Yeah.
Well done, Julius. Both of you are allowed to come on the show now, so congrats. That's the big win. I know that's what you were worried about when you were going for that last deadlift, or, you know, I get it. We're a big time here at Stash and Beard Show. Anyway, that's going to do it for this segment. We will be back on Friday. Not sure what we're talking about next, but hey, we'll be here. We'll be on Friday. Stash and Beard Show. Finger guns, baby!
Swear to God. See you guys.